Hi, my name's Jamie Fletcher. I am a research coordinator at Yorkshire MESMAC, and I'm joined today with my colleague Ben Vincent from the Open University. Their pronouns are they, them. We're going to be presenting to you some of our findings from the ICTA project, which is the Integrated Care for Trans Adults research project. Just a little bit about our team. It's an interdisciplinary team. It's a partnership between the Open University LGBT Foundation and Yorkshire MESMAC, and the research team is made up of a mixture of cis and trans researchers. So in terms of content of our presentation today, I'm going to give you a little bit of a context of UK trans healthcare, for those of you who don't know, and then we're going to focus our attention to three of the case studies from our research project. So the ICTA project started over a couple of years ago, and we put out a survey nationally, which over 2,000 trans people, trans adults, filled in. And from that, we were able to invite people to be interviewed as part of a number of case studies. We're going to focus our attention just to three of those today, and also share with you some of the views from service users and staff about how to improve trans healthcare. So a little bit of context for UK trans healthcare then. So over here we have a free national health service, and through this we're able to go to a GP and get a referral to a gender identity clinic. Now there's a number of gender identity clinics across the country, but there's only a small number of those relative to the amount of trans people that there are. These GICs operate a diagnosis model, which can be seen as being very pathologizing and gatekeeping of people's access to treatment. It's also worth noting that all GICs work differently, and that there is no standardization or consistency from GIC to GIC. There has been a few pilot services recently in primary care, but these have a narrow access criteria. And the only other way that people can access care is to pay for it privately, and if they're in that sort of fortunate position, or we see people self-medicating. This slide that you see here is a diagram of a pathway of moving that you can move through at a GIC. So this is from case study one. There's a lot of information here, so I'm not expecting you to take it all in right at this moment. So please do access the slides at a later point and look at this and interrogate it a little bit further. But what I want to draw your attention to is about the length of time it takes to go through the service. So from referral from your GP to your first appointment at a GIC, that can be 2 years and 4 months. So 2 years and 4 months from that referral to the first appointment. And then from the first appointment to the time that you see an endocrinologist where they can prescribe you hormones, that's a further 2.5 years. So we're looking at nearly 5 years just to kind of move through to get to a place of obtaining a prescription for hormones. So really lengthy time, and you can see that there is multiple steps and hurdles to overcome through this. So our three cases. Case study one is a gender identity clinic that's collaborating with a charity and community organisation in order to deliver peer support to people that are on that referral waiting list to the GIC. Case study two is a GIC doing something very similar to case study one, but with significant differences to that pathway. And that's significant differences by integrating with primary care. And case study three is a charity community organisation that's providing LGBTQIA plus healthcare training in primary care settings and giving a certification of good practice to those. So those are our three cases that we're going to share with you today. So case study one, so a bit of kind of background information. We've seen that pathway and we've seen that there's a long waiting list to be seen at a GIC. So GICs are this particular GIC from case study one could see that there's a waiting list and see that there's a problem of people waiting an extraordinary amount of time without any support. And some staff were aware of community organisations and peer support organisations doing some really interesting work locally, and that they're able to respond much quicker to give support to people. So a collaboration was set up and a relationship formed with a community organisation and the GIC, and together they were able to hire some trans peer support workers. Now, initially, those peer support workers, their role was very unclear, and it was unsure about what exactly that they could do or achieve. This is a very new thing for the service, but they did go on to create a number of support groups and do one-to-one peer support, but also most notably managing to set up a trans-only swimming session. It's important to note though that this role as a trans peer support worker, there are significant limitations to that role and about what they could achieve given their knowledge and their the time that they had and their resources, as well as their limitations over what they're able to help with the community. I can hear some noise in the background there. I don't know if someone's turned a microphone on there, but if you bear with us. Let's move on with that slide. So there are a number of comments and things that we've found out from people, and service users value the variety of support groups and how that they were facilitated. So this particular service user said, I also started going to Plus 25 group, and she always directed towards positivity, and she was good at setting boundaries in a way that made the environment feel safe. And yeah, I talked about things that were very difficult, and then she would reframe it of that's a...
Our speaker, Jamie, has just been muted.
Oh, I'll unmute myself again there. And the next service users I've been talking about, a trans swimming support group that was widely appreciated and providing access to activity that otherwise poses significant barriers. And this is a staff member saying that what we've got is we've got people who've not been swimming since they were a kid because of fears. And feedback was just so overwhelming in terms of people's stories and saying how positive this is for their mental health and their physical health. And it just really proved the need for it and the desire for it. We were getting 30 plus people each week, and that's amazing. But on the other side of things, outreach workers were overloaded. Trying to support too many people. There's an awful lot of people on that waiting list that are desperate for attention and need that support. And so a service user said, I just get this very strong feeling that gender outreach worker two is extremely overworked, and she's not able to respond to messages because there's just too many. outreach workers couldn't give people the main thing that they wanted, hormones. You know, people were really frustrated. They wanted hormones. That was the initial main thing. And I could help them do their depot, and I could help them with links to things, or just talk to them as a peer and give them support. But it very much felt like firefighting. That's from a staff member there.
8 minutes.
Other service users felt that the whole system is broken and needs abolishing. I'm going to move on and pass over to my colleague, Ben.
Thank you. Did I hear a call saying 5 minutes? I couldn't quite make out what was said.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to have to move really quickly. Case study two, I need to contextualise. We're looking at a case study whereby context of care is that it differs across England, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. They can have different rules about how healthcare is provided. And in this context, there was an older model which had even more gatekeeping involved, where one had to pass through mental health services before being able to even access the waits for the gender identity clinics. The new service that exists has got integrated teams that exist within primary care who people are referred back to, as well as this collaboration with a community organisation. So I'm going to very quickly move on, and so sorry to be rushing here. People talked very clearly about having had better experiences in this context compared to other clinics that they'd attended, a lot easier to talk to. One very interesting thing was that doctors were actually using social media to communicate with and talk to their patients, which made it much, much quicker to access information. People talked about clinicians even talking with them while there was a multidisciplinary team meeting discussing their care going on, so they could have live engagement with decision making, which is fantastic. And this served to really speed up care. This particular context is the only clinic in the UK where waiting times seem to be decreasing rather than increasing, which is a really, really important thing to acknowledge, even if the case is anonymized. Sorry that I'm zooming through these, but it wasn't all positive, because waiting times still fundamentally are an enormous problem across the entire of the UK, but we have people recognising that wasn't individual staff members' fault. There were some people who talked about how the coordination between different parts of the service were failing them still, but also difficulties with actually being able to reach the clinic directly. Now, this exists in tension with what I've just said about the availability of doctors through social media, but it kind of shows that that isn't a universally accessible or successful approach. So finally, our final case study is this community organisation that is certificating good practice and demonstrating that people have had training, and to get the highest level of certification, they have to demonstrate engagement with bridging prescriptions and trans status monitoring, which are both very valuable for trans communities. So we see people talking about how their practice had information to support them in changing their gender marker, which they think helped make that work more smoothly, that they weren't having people announced as Mr. or Miss or Mrs. when they were being called in, which was very helpful as well. And someone also talking about how they were supported as a trans masculine person in getting support with smear tests and their testosterone injections in a timely manner, which suggested a cultural competence had been acquired in this practice. However, the fact that a clinic had been trained didn't necessarily mean they wouldn't make mistakes, didn't guarantee all staff had had the training, didn't guarantee all staff remembered the training, which is a somewhat inevitable element, but also because people carried trauma from their historical medical interactions or had been left with a real sense of distrust, the training was unable to necessarily attend to some of those problems that can create barriers to healthcare. So very, very quickly, two final slides, and I'm not going to be able to read the quotes, but to highlight what people were saying. We had staff from within clinics talking about how a completely new system of care is needed, acknowledging that where they worked just wasn't able to handle the number of patients and wasn't able to engage in a way that was sort of culturally competent. And some people suggested about how funding needs to be centralized in order to better standardize care pathways across the country. Service users talked about all sorts of things, including the use of digital communication to better improve care, training so that trans healthcare isn't viewed as fundamentally specialist, moving it into more general settings. A real need to attend to intersectional marginalization in order to attend to racism, sexism, classism, ableism within healthcare, which I think it's fair to say disproportionately affects trans people. And ultimately, calls for abolition of the diagnostic and GIC model. But people have mixed ideas about what needed to happen there, whether we're ready to move into a primary care oriented system, acknowledging this was going to take time. And we can talk a bit more about what people said in our questions, because I'm aware we may have run over, but thank you very much for your patience there.
Merci pour la présentation. Alors, maintenant, on a une présentation de Yana.
De rien, c'était mon plaisir.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes. You can start.
Okay. So my name is Yana. I've been involved in trans activism in Russia for the past 11 years. I recently graduated from the University of Gothenburg, Sweden, with a master's degree in public health. Today, I will talk about the development of clinical practice guidelines on trans health in Russia. First, I'll talk about some historical and legal background. But I can't. Okay. So medical care for trans people has been practiced in the Soviet Union since late 60s, and in 1976 the rules were issued that permitted legal gender recognition. Those were intended for intersex people, but trans individuals used them as well. However, for two decades, medical care for trans people was nowhere formally systematized. Only in 1991, several months before the dissolution of the Soviet Union, methodological recommendations on the change of sex were approved by the Ministry of Health. Those were based on the fourth version of the standards of care. They introduced a number of terms which to this day remain peculiar to Russian medicine, such as nuclear and marginal transsexualism, as well as sexual reorientation, which is in an accurate translation of sex reassignment. The guidelines recommended assessment in a psychiatric institution and a one-year real-life test, which was a worldwide practice at that time. What was good about those recommendations? legal gender recognition was performed before the start of hormonal therapy and surgeries.
Okay.
I'm trying to show another slide. In 1999, soon after Russia adopted ICD-10, the Ministry of Health promulgated a clinical guideline for psychiatric disorders, which included transsexualism. According to the definition and differential diagnostics, transsexuals would not have intersex traits, schizophrenia, dual role transvestism, and homosexualism. That guideline was repealed in 2012, after which we had a legal vacuum. Currently, there is no document regulating diagnostics and treatment, so each doctor can choose whatever they like. And that's not bad, because there are some friendly doctors that can issue the diagnosis in 1 week. But what happened next? 2 years ago, in 2019, the Ministry of Health issued a decree regulating the development of clinical practice guidelines. The guidelines will now be developed by medical professional non-commercial organizations and approved by the Scientific Practical Council. What's important, they must be developed according to the principles of evidence-based medicine. So this decree basically outsourced the development of clinical guidelines to medical associations. And this is where we as trans activists found an opportunity to intervene. And I will talk here about our work. So in 2019, we established a group called Trans People for Access to Healthcare. It is still unregistered in an official way, but we are planning to register two organizations, a patient organization and a medical professional non-commercial organization. It is important for bureaucratic reasons to have both of them, although, of course, not all trans people like to be called patients. Our main goal is to develop clinical practice guidelines and other medical documents related to trans health. However, we faced many challenges in our work. Unfortunately, only doctors can be members of the medical organization. As a public health specialist, I cannot enter this organization. And we don't have trans people who are doctors. So this medical organization is led by cisgender men, which is not good. Even though those doctors are friendly, they are not competent enough. They know nothing about the latest developments in international trans health, and most of them don't read in English. Furthermore, they don't have competence in evidence-based medicine and cannot write clinical practice guidelines of sufficient quality. Another problem is that they have low motivation. They need to be pushed all the way to do anything. Next, we faced obstacles when trying to register both organizations with the Ministry of Justice. We didn't want to use pathologizing terminology such as transsexualism. We want to use gender diverse, but the ministry said there are no such patients and no such disease. So we'll probably go to court, but currently we don't have money for that. Finally, there is a scarcity of data to make evidence-based recommendations. And I will talk more about that later. So first, we had to decide how to entitle our recommendations. Despite the adoption of ICD-11 by the World Health Organization, Russia still follows ICD-10. So the terminology is still transsexualism and gender identity disorder. The good news is that the title of the recommendations should not necessarily follow ICD-10. So we'll probably choose a combination of gender dysphoria and gender incongruence. It seems we can't get rid of gender dysphoria altogether because the term is used widely in epidemiological studies that we rely on. Since clinical practice guidelines are written according to evidence-based medicine, we need to prove effectiveness of medical transition. To do that, we conducted a search in Scopus, Web of Science, and PubMed with the following terms, and in the end, we found 7 eligible systematic reviews. You can see the list below. We assessed the methodological quality of those systematic reviews according to the guideline developed by the Russian Ministry of Health and found that all of them had high or satisfactory quality. We also found that the results were coherent. Namely, medical transition improved the quality of life and various psychosocial outcomes. Third, all the outcomes were important. Based on these criteria, we can give a strong recommendation of in favor of conducting medical transition procedure, and that's a good result. However, it's not so good as it looks on the surface. Epidemiological studies are not specific on the hormonal treatment regimen or type of surgery. Some studies mix them all together. So while we can recommend medical transition in general, there is a lack of data on specific procedures, and we are obliged to rely on evidence of low credibility, such as consensus of experts. The next question we had is whether we should include legal guidelines. Previous Soviet and Russian guidelines had it included, so we decided to mention it as well. The guidelines are developed according to a standard template that consists of sections such as diagnosis, treatment, and rehabilitation. Can procedure be a part of the treatment or rehabilitation? In the end, we were greatly helped by this article that gives evidence that legal gender recognition improves mental health. So, yes, we decided to include that in the treatment section.
5 minutes.
Another issue we had is how to include the informed consent model in the guidelines. Unfortunately, there's no epidemiological evidence to support the choice of informed consent model over the traditional gatekeeping model. The other problem is that we are not sure that it's legally possible for an endocrinologist to prescribe hormones without medical indications confirmed with a diagnosis according to the Russian legislation. So this is a work in progress, but we hope to succeed one day. Thank you.
Merci pour la présentation. Maintenant, c'est au tour de Anne.
Thank you for the presentation. Now we have Anne Millet. Good morning. I am Michet. I am a social worker. I live in Buenos Aires, Argentina. I specialize in mental health and I work at a mental health hospital that belongs to I also work at the Ministry of Health of the nation. I'm also a drag queen, a king. And I wanted to present a book that we published towards the end of last year. It was published by Puntos Suspensivos Editorial Publishing House, This is a publishing house that mainly focuses on publishing trans voices, both in poetry, and this is a collection of essays written by trans people. The book is called Cissexism and Health, and it aims to address the connection of these two topics from a transmasculine perspective. I especially wanted to focus on three ideas because we don't have much time. But before that, I wanted to thank you all for this space. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you to all this effort of holding this event in three languages. Some languages are missing, but we know that this is a huge effort you've made, especially from the people for the people from the Global South. Many people from the Global South have no opportunity to learn another language, an international, or attempt to exclude us in this regard. Sometimes to us as activists or health.
Currently, we don't have money for that. Finally, there is a scarcity of data to make evidence-based recommendations. And I will talk more about that later. Okay. So first, we had to decide how to entitle our recommendations. Despite the adoption of ICD-11 by the World Health Organization, Russia still follows ICD-10, so the terminology is still transsexualism and gender identity disorder. The good news is that the title of the recommendations should not necessarily follow ICD-10. We will probably choose a combination of gender dysphoria and gender incongruence. It seems we can't get rid of gender dysphoria altogether because the term is used widely in epidemiological studies that we rely on. Since clinical practice guidelines are written according to evidence-based medicine, we need to prove effectiveness of medical transition. To do that, we conducted a search in Scopus, Web of Science, and PubMed with the following terms, and in the end, we found 7 eligible systematic reviews. You can see the list below. We assessed the methodological quality of those systematic reviews according to the guideline developed by the Russian Ministry of Health, and found that all of them had high or satisfactory quality. We also found that the results were coherent, namely medical transition improved the quality of life and various psychosocial outcomes. Third, all the outcomes were important. Based on these criteria, we can give a strong recommendation of in favor of conducting medical transition procedure, and that's a good result. However, it's not so good as it looks on the surface. Epidemiological studies are not specific on the hormonal treatment regimen or type of surgery. Some studies mix them all together. So while we can recommend medical transition in general, there is a lack of data on specific procedures, and we are obliged to rely on evidence of low credibility, such as consensus of experts. The next question we had is whether we should include legal guidelines. Previous Soviet and Russian guidelines had it included, so we decided to mention it as well. But the guidelines are put to a standard template that consists of sections such as diagnosis, treatment, and rehabilitation. Can procedure be a part of the treatment or rehabilitation? In the end, we were greatly helped by this article that gives evidence that legal gender recognition improves mental health. So, yes, we decided to include that in the treatment section.
5 minutes.
Another issue we had is how to is how to include the informed consent model in the guidelines. Unfortunately, there's no epidemiological evidence to support the choice of informed consent model over the traditional gatekeeping model. The other problem is that we are not sure that it's legally possible for an endocrinologist to prescribe hormones without medical indications confirmed with a diagnosis according to the Russian legislation. So this is a work in progress, but we hope to succeed one day. Thank you.
Merci pour la présentation. Maintenant, c'est au tour de Anne.
Thank you for the presentation. Now we have Anne Millet. Good morning. I am Michet. I am a social worker. I live in Buenos Aires, Argentina. I specialize in mental health, and I work at mental health hospital that belongs to the, I also work at the Ministry of Health of the nation. I'm also a drag queen, a king, and I wanted to present a book that we published towards the end of last year. It was published by Puntos Suspensivos editorial publishing house. This is a publishing house that mainly focuses on publishing trans voices, both in poetry, and this is a collection of essays written by trans people. The book is called Cissexism and Health, and it aims to address the connection of these two topics from a transmasculine perspective. I especially wanted to focus on three ideas because we don't have much time. But before that, I wanted to thank you all for this space. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you to all this effort of holding this event in three languages. Some languages are missing, but we know that this is a huge effort you've made, especially from the people for the people from the Global South. Many people from the Global South have no opportunity to learn another language, and international fora tend to exclude us in this regard. Sometimes to us as activists or health workers or as trans people, simply, it can be very difficult for us to have access to a global perspective of what we are, how we are doing as a community, what is the situation of our community in other countries. And of course, we need to try and make an effort and read the news, etc. To me, it's very clear that we need more international events, even if it's very difficult for me to have virtual events. They need to be virtual and online. Because if these events are just in-person events, then once again, those who can pay only those that can pay an airline ticket or an enrollment fee will be attending. So thank you to the organizers for this huge effort. I'm sure this has been very rewarding, but very difficult as well. I would like to focus on three main ideas in the book, although there are many more. It is uploaded on the Hoover platform, so you can have a look at it there. It's now available only in Spanish, but we're now translating it into Portuguese because we want to cater to languages from the Global South, and we want to really have a conversation with our neighbor in and brother country, Brazil. First of all, I talk about a category that I have built to identify myself. I am a transmasculine lesbian, and I felt the need to create this term because when I started to use masculine pronouns, or when I had a surgery, there wasn't a category that would represent me. This is a category that appears, and this is nice when you invent things when you're older. It emerges in a soft way because it knows that there are no hard or clear-cut identities. So it's a category that appeared but might be left behind at some point, and that makes it particularly powerful. I felt the need to create the category because when I started using masculine pronouns and I decided to have surgery to intervene in my body, everyone assumes that I'm a trans man. And that move erases my lesbianism in a way. There is this new identity inscription and it eliminates another identity. So that happened a few years ago, and at the time I didn't know anyone that was trans, masculine, and lesbian, that considered themselves lesbian. I knew trans men that maybe didn't know that they were lesbians, and I also knew trans people that admitted that they had been lesbians, but that through the transition were not lesbians anymore. There was this elimination of the previous identity. So I felt the need to create this new idea, and I thought it was very, I think it's important to make the effort to share these identities, because I trust that the more we can use, we can create categories in the world, it is clearer that gender is a social construct. So we can make it be whatever we want it to be with the different types of resistance this and political struggles it entails. But if we do this, it becomes harder to justify that it's biological, those terrible things that people say. Something else that I would like to share is that about the book is that I have called it de-cissexualization. I take on the G. Valentine's idea of the heterosexualization of the public space. This is a 90s book. It really blew my mind from the first time I read it. And it makes it very clear that the public space is not naturally heterosexual, but rather that it has been heterosexualized through an appropriation practice. I also take two concepts from Val Flores, an Argentinian lesbian woman who talks about this heterosexualization of educational practices. And this is connected to what Valentine says. Valentine says that the space has been heterosexualized, and then Val says that we need to unlearn that heterosexualization, and we need to create this degenderization of our public spaces and of our schools. And I also talk about the depathologization of the trans collective. I believe that the campaign in Argentina called Depato Trans in Spanish, I believe that this campaign marked a turning point in global trans activism. There was international coordination, simultaneous events were held throughout the world, and it was essential, really. Regardless of what happened after this path towards depathologization, there is also this need to the need to meet globally became evident through that campaign. And with these ideas of depathologization, de-heterosexualization, I suggest de-cissexualization as a process to unlearn cissexist perspectives and practices, mainly in health, because it's the field I'm interested in. But also we need to understand that cissexism is strong, so de-cissexualization is also very strong. If there is a cissexist practice, we have the opportunity to unlearn it and to create a new learn to live in this world. Finally, the last idea I wanted to share with you, which I believe is the most interesting one, is this trabajadores inesperados idea. I started to come up with these ideas as I am a mental health, when I was a mental health resident in the city of Buenos Aires, I was the only trans person working in that hospital.
5 minutes.
Thank you. And I began to identify different cissexism forms when we need to meet as workers and not just as users. This is just a situation. As I was writing a book, a non-binary social worker friend wrote to me, also a resident at a hospital, and they asked me if I changed my registration in the digital system as a professional. I explain that my hospital lacks a digital system, but that I had changed my professional document and my stamp or my seal, which is what I have to use every day. For us, health professionals and trans people, when we haven't changed our national ID cards, it's kind of complex when you prescribe something to a user and the name that appears is different than the name you introduce yourself with. And professional health professionals' signature and stamps are tools we use every day. So I told them that I had changed that, and they tell me that they had requested a change of name in the clinical records as a hospital user, and also the professional signature. They said that the clinical records were changed immediately, but the signature change as a professional was not being made. In Argentina, we can enroll in any institution thanks to the name we want, thanks to the wonderful gender identity law we have. So this friend gets their name changed as a user, but not as a professional. So that really shows the situation in mental health, in health institutions in general. This is a country that has a vanguard law. They can picture us as users, that they do not expect us to appear in other areas of life. This is why I come up with this category called unexpected workers or trabajadores inesperados. We are trans health workers, and we are unexpected in hospitals, in universities, in a surgery. And this is a suggestion and some criticism to this Congress and the organization. It also happened to me that when I started to come up with these ideas, I was an unexpected professional because I'm a professional. In that hospital, I am a social worker. And over time, I noticed that excluded the experience of many other trans people that might also have a strategic perspective on cissexism, but they're not professionals. So this is why I think I propose the concept of unexpected workers and not unexpected professionals, because there are other people who are who do administrative work, cleaning work, who are security guards, etc. They also have a perspective and a strategic position when it comes to how cissexism works in that space. I would like to read out to you just an excerpt from the book. The people that live in health institutions know how different things can be from different perspectives. Depending on our task or work, we have different spaces and we can identify different situations. In a way, we could say that depending on who we are and what we do, we inhabit different institutions within the same institution. We don't use the same toilets, we don't go to the same meetings. Our voices have different values in the different institutional micro-worlds. The physical spaces where we rest, work, have lunch, or change clothes are different. What we do and the people we do it with are different. Our position in the institutional hierarchy are clearly different, and also our social class, our skin color, stories and wishes that will be different as well. I think it is clear that the perspectives of each health trans worker will be different because the perspectives are different as well. And I'm really passionate about this idea of sharing the ways in which we feel and identify cissexism, because I'm sure that many are similar. Because although I know about the capacities of pressure systems, they can inhabit different worlds, I also know that they are repetitive when they reproduce. We need to see how humiliation and word devaluing are generalized. Also, when people assume your gender, when they look at you and when they discredit your identity in each pathway, within the institutions that are intrinsically cissexist. This is also powerful, and I can anticipate that this power is huge. It happens to me that finding the social justification of my issues really helps me, and I can better understand how cissexism works, and I can imagine different ways in which I can bring it down. I dream of us being many together, and I'm sure that all of this can be transformed. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentation. The next one is recorded, so I'm gonna share my screen.
Hi everyone, my name is Evelyn Callahan and I am a research fellow at the Open University.
I'm Michael Petch, pronouns they, them. I'm a researcher at LGBT Foundation.
And today we are going to be presenting healthcare experiences of older trans people and disabled and chronically ill trans people in the UK, preliminary findings from the ICTA project. So the ICTA project, or Integrating Care for Trans Adults, is an NIHR-funded project which aims to develop effective models for the health services needed to support trans adults before, during, and after they are seen by gender identity services. Specifically, the focus is on effective integration of care, or how to make healthcare more joined up.
So through our project, we conducted a screening survey to get a baseline of what people's experiences of healthcare were, and to recruit people for our case studies and community interviews. The case studies you will have heard about in in a previous presentation from our colleagues Ben Vincent and Jacob Fletcher, but we're going to be talking about the community interviews. So within those interviews, we have spoken with 91 trans people so far, and these are ongoing as we are still recruiting to certain subgroups in the community. So with these interviews, as we've mentioned, there are subgroups that are populations of particular interest that we think will have a noteworthy experience when accessing healthcare as trans people who also experience other forms of oppression. So the two we're talking about today are
trans people.
There are 35 in our older sample and 43 in our disabled sample. Final stage of the project will be producing learning materials for a variety of audiences, including clinicians, mental health professionals, and the trans community themselves.
So our findings from our older population, and this is was 50 plus, and our particular sample was age between 51 and 80 years of age, as you saw. So we had a few key findings from this group. First of all, was waiting. Of course, this is something that is of concern for all of the people in our sample. It was a very wide ranging experience, but there is a particular kind of experience of waiting with our older group. So people being seen for a first appointment at GICs now have been waiting up to 5+ years. Now, first appointment is not, there's no care provided at the first appointment. That's just to get in the door of the GIC. And of course, people being referred now have been waiting, will have been waiting exponentially longer when they do get seen. So waiting is a huge issue across the population. But it took on an additional urgency for older participants. As one participant explained, "I don't know how long I've got, none of us do. But you know, I'm at an age now where I'm looking back more than I'm looking forward. So I would like to think that when somebody of advancing years comes forward and says, 'Look, you know, I've been miserable for the last 59 years. I'd like to live out my life as the person that I really am.' They would sit up and say, 'Yeah, okay, we'll do what we can right away.' Rather than saying, 'Oh, well, you've got to wait behind all the 18-year-olds. They've got another 60 years to live, you know. Hang on a minute, that ain't fair.'" So this participant is expressing frustration that many of our participants in this group expressed, which was that they felt that they had already been waiting many years to transition to you know, live as their authentic selves, and that they were being asked to wait even longer, and that was quite disrespectful, as well as the infantilizing attitude that some felt they were subjected to. They felt that they were old enough to know their own minds and should be able to consent to whatever they wished to do for their own bodies. And finally, that kind of urgency of not having enough time left to enjoy it, to enjoy the kind of results of the process. Another one of our kind of key findings was with transition-related healthcare. So those kind of specific healthcare services, once they were able to access them. So additional considerations for older people taking hormone replacement therapy, or HRT, that can include using estrogen patches or gel instead of pills. Could be similar with testosterone gel instead of shots, to decrease the risk of heart disease, stroke, and blood clots. Now, what's really important to note here is that this does not mean that older trans people should not be taking HRT or can't take HRT safely. They may wish to use these different forms, as I've mentioned, but they may not get along with those different forms as well. And it's all about informed consent at the end of the day. They should be told all of the risks, but HRT is important medication. So it should be valued that way, and they should be able to make the decision for themselves, considering the risks about what's the best path forward for themselves. Additionally, similarly, an increased surgical risk. This is for any surgery. As you get older, there's an increased risk. But again, that should be up to the individual to make the informed consent themselves. But some of them were concerned about those risks and maybe were selecting not to go through with certain surgeries for that reason. Others felt that they were too old for surgical intervention, not in a medical sense, but in a social sense, in a kind of personal sense, that there was no point. That they didn't have enough years left to enjoy it, to utilize it. For lower surgery, many of them described not being sexually active and not planning to be so not feeling that there was a reason for themselves to have that intervention. Additionally, hair removal is more challenging on gray and white hair. So that's a consideration for our older population. And all of these above examples are relevant to people transitioning later in life. Some of them, like HRT, are ongoing concerns. But our historic transitioners as well, people who transitioned many years previous, they faced a tertiary care system. So they were not able to get referred directly to the gender identity clinic. They had to be referred through mental health services first. So there was that extra barrier and other barriers that were unique to their historic experience as well. And then finally, non-transition related healthcare. So social care and end of life planning was a chief concern for this group. It's something they were thinking about, something they were worried about, as well as appropriate screening. So in the UK, we have screening programs for several diseases, mainly for cancers. So we have this one participant's experience of trying to get a mammogram. And as he described, I developed this breast abscess and the GP's advice was go and get yourself a mammogram. So I rang Breast Test Wales to get a mammogram and was told that we don't see trans people in this service. And I was actually shocked because I thought they did. I thought they actually ran male clinics, but they don't. So even if you're a man with breast cancer or if you're male identifying, you have to book a mammogram through your local hospital rather than through the breast test people. And it usually takes longer because you're accessing a specialized service because they don't run male clinics very often. So for this individual, this was actually quite an urgent situation. It was not a routine check. It was actually symptomatic. They were symptomatic and seeking a mammogram. At the time we had spoken to this person, this incident had happened several months previous, and they had to that date not been successful in accessing a mammogram. And this was an ongoing issue for him. So this is very concerning that and a pretty blatant example of discrimination in healthcare against this person because of being trans. So our key takeaways for this group are that decreased waiting lists are needed through an informed consent model. We need to support people that are transitioning later in life. That more research into medical transit interventions for older people is needed, and a need for appropriate services through the end of life and beyond.
So now we're going to look at some of the key findings from our disabled and chronically ill sample, starting looking at their experiences of non-transition related healthcare. So a lot of times there were instances of mistreatment and individuals were unsure whether this was because of transphobia. This was also made more complex as there were more often more healthcare interactions, and so there were more possibilities for negative experiences and incompetent care. A frequent experience was struggling with gendered hospital wards, whether this was not being given a choice over the ward which they feel more appropriately reflects their gender, or the ward which they feel the safest in. And again, this should always be person-centered and be led by the individual as to where they would like to be placed within a ward. There were instances of medical trauma as well, so people experiencing complete mishandlings of their disability or chronic illness. And there were, lastly, instances were quite frequently of self-management of care. This is where people were having to manage their condition or their multiple conditions and having to be an expert in their own right. In some instances, this meant foregoing some healthcare in order to access others, whether this was because their conditions were related and one needed to be resolved first before the other could, or whether this was because they didn't have the capacity or the energy to manage multiple specialists and manage multiple relationships with others. This ties into transition-related healthcare as well, as this for some people was also that they would manage alongside this and a specialist they would manage alongside this. So when looking at transition-related care, there are some transition steps that are complicated by conditions. As we mentioned before, with some of the people in the older sample, there are certain risks that increase, such as strokes and heart disease, and these will be prevalent in the disabled and chronically ill sample as well. Having a disability or chronic illness can also cause delays or prevent care at every step of the pathway. And that includes the GP referral to the gender identity clinic, which is how people are able to then access care. It can also include referrals from the GIC to accessing surgery. So we have a quote here from someone who wanted to get a referral from their GP to their gender identity clinic, but was struggling and was unable to access that. And so in their words, "So I literally went to my GP with a list of information for them. So I actually did their job for them, slammed it on their desk and said, right, refer me now unless you want a dead body in 48 hours. And it's this level of extremity that we particularly found disabled and chronically ill trans people are having to go to in order to get the care that they need. So then, lastly, looking at the absence of care, which often occurred, this could be focused around a particular condition, whether that was something that was under-researched and not fully known or supported. Or due to a lack of diagnosis in some instances where people would struggle to access diagnoses for conditions. There were also instances of what procedures were accessible to people. So there was one instance where someone couldn't have a sigmoid colonoscopy vaginoplasty because that just wasn't available to them due to their IBS. But the procedure that they would want, which was a peritoneal vaginoplasty, isn't available on the NHS system currently. And then lastly, on this point of absence of care, and this kind of ties together the experience of disabled and chronically ill trans people together, is this quote from this one person talking about why they decided at one point in their life to delay a referral to a GIC. So there was at least at peak, I've had 7 different specialists, 7 or 8 different specialists. at the moment, I've only got the two that I've just been signed from, and now I'm back waiting for other specialists. But it's been hell. It's a full-time job, and honestly, I wish I could do anything else. And I think what makes this case even more challenging is that since that incident, they had then gone on to seek referral to a gender identity clinic, only to be denied specifically relating to their disability. And so this is an instance outright where this blocks disabled trans people from being able to access care they need. And so our key takeaways from this are an increased level of autonomy, again through an informed consent model, support for people exploring transition choices. Again, this is kind of key to the informed consent, making sure that they understand the risks that are there and are supported by services when they make their choice as to what they want to do. And then lastly, more research into how medical interventions can interact with various different conditions for different individuals.
Okay, thank you everyone for the presentation. We ran out of time, so we can do the Q&A right now, but you can, there's an option in Vuva where you can ask questions and other participants can answer. And for the next session, you can access the link to Vuva, and Francisco posted the information also on the chat. Thank you everyone.